let's talk about these two. Oh, it's exciting. Right, Carl from Studio Hi-Fi again, part of Studio Incar. What we're going to do today, we're going to compare the Special 40 to the Q Concept 300. It's a Dynaudio Special 40 and the Q Acoustics Concept 300. A comparison that I think is a great comparison, and it's closer than you may think. As with everything that I do, it's completely unscripted, so I genuinely speak my mind as we're going along. There's no plinky plonkiness to my sort of comparisons at all. So I believe the Concept 300, because it wears the Q badge, is a bit of an unsung hero. I think people write it off. It looks a little strange. I think it looks great. But it gets overlooked because of the budget nature of the rest of Q's lines, which also work well at their price point. They're a master of being better than their price point. But the Q Concept 300, the tensegrity stand with the decoupled bass from the speaker, which not many people really know about. They kind of just assume it's a triangulated strung stand on with a speaker on top. It's not. It's completely decoupled. The dual cabinet, the drive units. And when I say dual cabinet, it's like a cabinet inside another cabinet and then a gel coat between the two. All just gorgeous, gooey, lovely stuff that I want to hear when it comes to decoupling drivers from the room. And then we've got the Special 40, my personal favourite speaker. If the 300 beats a Special 40, I won't mask that. That is the way that it is. If it doesn't, then I'll also, you know, we'll discuss that. But I've got a feeling there's going to be some really lovely moments in today's review. And for me listening, I'll put a couple of sound clips up. It's not going to be from the snazzy mic, just be from the camera mic. Your opinion of that, it means nothing to me. I understand that you're not going to get anything from a YouTube video, but you can possibly get something in the way of comparing the two. Now, my product... That's my wife again. She did this the last time and made a load of racket during the video. Anyway, what I'm going to do today is going to be a vinyl front end. It's going to be a Project X2 and the new Project Phonobox RS2, which I'm really excited to get out of its box. It's still in its box right now, but we'll set that up now. I'll show you which tracks I'm going to use. I've got my trusty notepad. I'm going to take some notes, and let's get to it. Let's have a listen, and I'll write down my findings, and I'll discuss them with you. And a few people have asked for this one, but it genuinely has been one that I wanted to do myself. I just wanted to give myself some time to do it. Well, it's a good. I've got a good morning written all over it. This has. Catch you in a minute. So a setup. I've got the 300s in first. You can see the Special 40s behind me. These are the original Grey Oak Special 40. So these are they're my own Special 40s. They sit out here for when we haven't got new stock on demonstration. We sold our last set of Special 40s from stock last weekend. So we're waiting on new stuff to turn up. So these get brought back out. In terms of sound and build, they're exactly the same as the current Special 40. They're just not, the current Special 40 just isn't a limited run like these were. The new Special 40s are a a better finish in terms of their actual finish. To see that, I've got a video that I did a little while ago that I can link you to. So what I'm gonna do is a little bit different this time, because I don't want to be wheeling speakers in and out. I'm gonna listen to all my tracks on these, and then I'm gonna listen to all the same tracks on them, and I'll mark down which tracks. I'll probably put some writing in the description as well to which tracks that I'm listening to. It seems to be quite popular, which is cool. But I'll get them now and I'll show you what I'm listening to. So on at the moment, Zaba, Glass Animals. It's one of my favourite albums. It just sounds gorgeous. Then a load of you will hate me for this, but Noel Gallagher's charity gigs is live. This is Dreams We Have as Children. I love this album. My best mate Mark bought me this as a moving in gift. I didn't know we could get it on vinyl. You could only get it on iTunes at the time. It was on no other streaming service, so love it. Paul Weller is on this as well. It's the Royal Albert Hall. It sounds really nice. Unlike a lot of, you know, older Oasis stuff and things like that, it actually has got some decent sounds to it. Ocean Colour Scene, album that I've not listened to before. I want to throw something in there just to maybe push me to one side on how something sounds that I haven't heard before, which is good. It's a nice little test for yourself. Block Party Hymns, an album I know really well, especially Different Drugs, last track on the B-side. Unfortunately, it's on the Inner Grooves, but it is what it is. Good sounding album. Yeah, great that. And then Alanis Morissette, Live in Switzerland. There'll only be one track on there that I'll want to listen to. I can't really remember what one it was now. But yeah, anyway, that'll be going on. Again, another nice album. So I'm not going to listen to every one of them entirely. I'm probably going to listen to a few tracks from each. But I'm just letting the amp and the new phono stage and everything at the moment just warm up for an hour, and then off we go. So I'm using, I think I said earlier, that the new Phono Box RS from Project, which I've been quite excited about. We've got the Hegel V10 as well turning up soon, so them two sit in a very similar bracket, so it'll be nice, and it'd be lovely to compare those two, see if we can get which one's the victor. Hegel H390, now you could argue that it might be slightly over spec for the speakers in this test, being sub £3,000. I just know the amp well, so it gives me a good reference. I know what I'm doing. I'm not gonna change anything else about it. You should see as well that the volume will remain the same throughout, about 65, between 65 and 70. If it's any higher, it means I'm having fun. I'll take that as a good thing. The X2, which has a 2M silver, an Autophone 2M silver, moving magnet. I want to change a couple of things about it, because I think the azimuth slightly off, VTA slightly off. I just want to go through it myself and have a little play with it. It may be that it's set like that because they've tested it and that's the way that it works best. Although I want to have a little poke around with changing a few things but anyway, the Cord Epic XL speaker cable, and we've got Cord Interconnects, Project Connect it from the deck to the Phono stage. And then Cord Shoreline Analog from the Phono stage out to the amp. There's a few nice cables in there, but not tens of thousands of pounds worth of cables. Probably a grand's worth of cables all told. Maybe even less, actually. About 600 quid, I think, cables. You know, they've got to be good, but whether you buy into the differences is completely up to you. So I'm going to carry on listening, shoot a little bit of video, take a few notes. I've already subconsciously been taking a couple of notes, but I have to kind of try and write them off because everything's just fired up. Let's get a bit of temperature and then off we go. I've left the heater off today as well because I'm sick of it getting in my videos. So it's, you won't see that because nothing happened, but it's pretty cold in here. Yeah. Let's go. There we go. It's a landslide, guys, to be fair. I know how good this speaker is. What I've never done is spent time with a pair of them and put them back to back on the same tracks and the same source, the same volumes. I had a bit of a muck around early on with the gain on the phono stage and the volume on the amp, so you'll probably see a bit all over the place in the video, but it was just me figuring out early on what I needed to do to get the same relative volumes. Sensitivity seems to be quite similar to the ear, you know, in terms of the number on the amp and output from the speakers. But yeah, I'll get into it and then I'll tell you which one's the best, in my opinion, of course. Started with the 300, as you saw. I've been through the system with you. You know what, you know what's what there. Let me just turn that music down there. Right. First things first. Pause it, try and read it, if you like. My wife had a go at reading it earlier on. Bless her. I've got extreme resolution at £3,000. Now, I've seen people selling these at 2.5 with their stands. I don't know if that's, you know, we haven't had a bulletin about a £500 price drop. We have had had them approach us with a £2,500 deal for the speakers and then £600 for the Tensegrity stands. So I'm going to review them at three grand. The people selling them at 2.5 with stands, I don't really know what's going on there, but if that's the case and that's come from Q, then we adjust our price and so on. And these at £2,700. Now, these were, of course, £2,500 when they first come out. For various finish reasons and stuff like that, they've gone up to £2,700. Now, in terms of value for money, none of this I've written down, but in terms of value for money, you get more speaker, more stand, more kind of everything with this speaker than you do with the Special 40. You just get a speaker, you don't get a stand. So yeah, its box count is higher for the money. That has no bearing on sound at all, just box count for per pound. All right. I've put for the 300s, we'll start here. I've got a few points and then we'll move on to Special 40s. Some of the points on this I kept off of my writing until I'd put the Special 40 in the system, because I don't think it's fair to say, oh, you know, this speaker's dull, when my reference would be more lively, for instance. So I thought I'd get them both listened to and take my findings from there. So extreme resolution at £3,000 price point. The tweeter in this speaker is what impressed me the most when we first got them, and still impresses me now. But it is, say, 0.5 or a single dB beyond the rest of the speaker. It's quite pronounced. Not trickery, not like some smiley face sort of speakers. It's just a more obvious high frequency sound. I've written singing afterwards. Now, I caught myself singing when I was listening to them. That's just me enjoying music, and if I'm enjoying music, they're playing well. So that you could probably read a lot more into that, that I would subconsciously just burst out into song. It means a lot, you know, what amount of money can buy that, you know. They don't play well from cold, and I've put next to that, really big deal. Now, little backstory, when we first got the 500s, which is where our eyes were set when we took Q1, was the concept lines. We got the 500s out of the box, we plugged them in, we started playing them, and three or four of us looked at each other, and I thought we'd made a mistake. I really didn't like the way they sounded. I was unimpressed. Fast forward just 6 to 7 hours, and they were a completely different speaker. Completely different. Really, really gorgeous sounding speaker, which sounded way beyond their price point. Now, I've not experienced much in the way of speakers being cold and having such a... when I say cold, I mean kind of room temperature, but not being played for a little while. Right, so these haven't been played for a couple of months, forgive me. But, you know, there's a huge difference between them being cold, to the point where I had them in and I was checking my record player, I was checking the phono stage, I was wondering why where's this thin hollow sound coming from? Something's got to be wrong. Now, I'm not an advocate of vinyl. I do like it, but I like it more for its nostalgia and its physical media. I don't necessarily, it's not my go-to source. So of course I'm gonna blame that. But you know, giving it an hour and a half with some loud volumes and some, you know, just giving the speakers a good zhuzh, really changed them, and then they turned back into that speaker that I like and have liked for a long time. But the reason I put an emphasis on that being a really big deal is, do you want to come home, walk in, link your phone up to your amp or put a record on, and then have to wait for a period of time before it starts to sound good? You know, speakers will typically have a run in and then they'll kind of just sound better from there, if not, and then they plateau. Whereas these need a little bit of a run up each time you listen to them. Now, if they're being listened to daily, that's probably slightly different. In here, they don't get listened to as often as you would do at home. So you might find that time may be 5 or 10 minutes, like it is with some amplifiers. But I would probably, if they were, you know, I have got a set of these at home actually, but I run them Class D and it's always on. I would say that's a big deal. If you want something to just be bang straight off the bat, you know, as good as it always is, each time, it's that one. But when it does get going, it is a gorgeous speaker. No room vibration, can trick you into thinking and feeling that bass is absent. Now, that is, you have to be kind of well versed in clinical listening and stuff like that to understand really what that's about. So when you decouple a speaker from a room, you effectively should get its truest bass response, because it's not exciting the room, it's not exciting the floor, things like that. And what that can do, because you haven't got that vibration in whatever you're sitting on or that feeling through the floor, subconsciously can lead you to believe and feel like there's no bass weight. It is there, it's just that you hear it and it affects the fundamental frequencies upwards from there, and really sort of bolsters them as well, more so than you would probably think. But that's what the decoupled speaker from the stand does in the room. It kind of deletes any resonance from what it would be attached to if it was coupled, like the Special 40 is. So, you know, if you do get them in your room, or if you do go for a demo and you think that they're bass light, they aren't a bass light speaker. They're just decoupled properly, which is possibly my favorite part of the speaker, is the design of the decoupling. I wish every speaker was as decoupled as it is. All the sand and heavy stands in the world aren't going to do what, you know, maglev is going to do to a speaker, or true decoupling is going to do to a speaker. Just get it off of anything in the room. You know, and that affects things like record players and equipment as well, to a certain degree, you know. So yeah, that's written in there. Well-rounded bass, not particularly fast. So it's not a speedy speaker, it's not a lazy speaker, or it doesn't sound slow, it's just on the line, you know. It has a nice full sound in bottom end, which isn't, you know, lightning quick. Sometimes a speaker can be so quick that it gets a little too clinical, and a little bit fatiguing to listen to. Neither of these are like that, you know. Lovely sounding transparent high frequency. Now, transparent and clear and things like that are terms that are banded around, but I can hear this speaker like looking through a pane of glass. Like it is just, it just seems to go on forever. The tweeter is easily the best driver out of the two in there, in my opinion. Less integrated mid-range. So I've got lovely sounding, transparent, high frequency, less integrated mid-range. These two together don't marry like these two do. Now, the marriage of those two in this speaker and its crossover is probably its party trick. It's amazing, the cohesion that this speaker has. This is a little bit more separated. It's a little bit more... There's a little bit more mess in that handover than there is in any Dyne speaker. Bear with me. That's not to say it's a muddy sounding speaker. It really isn't. You know, you could possibly get by without ever hearing that. You know, it's just that putting them two side by side, when one excels at a certain thing, it's bound to be better than the other. It was just a little bit more confused in the handover from mid-range to treble, you know. Not a fan of high volumes. If you were to put these two in a ring and volume was to be their knockout blow, this is going to win every time. So if you are a Serwin Vega style listener and you like to have your music on full whack all the time, you probably won't be listening or looking for this speaker anyway. But if you were, scratch that. This plays beautifully up to a particular volume, which is loud, don't get me wrong. Then it goes, and that's it. There's no warning, there's no breakup. It just goes from being lovely to full on flapping and completely losing control. Now, I'm saying that's up high. We're talking 90 something on the Hegel amp, which is out of 100. So that's very high. This, you can flatten that out into these, and I'd assume you could flatten the 590 out into them, and then you could probably add a power amp to the 590 and flatten that out into them as well. These are just keep on coming. But that's a Dynaudio thing. That's a big voice call, big motor, and a well-designed crossover. That's just what they're going to do. Fit and finish. The finish is less so than the Special 40 on the Concept 300. It's just, it is built as a whole lot more speaker per pound than this speaker. So it has to be built to a particular standard. The lacquer finish isn't as flat as the Special 40. It's probably just slightly less so than this one, but the new one, it doesn't stand a chance. The new one is glass flat. As you've probably seen in my previous comparison video between the Special 40 Limited and the Special 40, the new one. No differences other than the finish, and the finish is just impeccable. I've got still a gorgeous speaker, /striking/ statement speaker. Look at it. I mean it. There's no other speaker that looks like this, which is great. There are a lot of speakers that look like bookshelf speakers. You know, the Tensegrity stand is really special. It's actually what switched me on to Q Acoustics, really, is just this stand. I just found it incredible. I love companies that do bold things. And, you know, the design and the decoupling of it is, again, perfect. And it's a looker. You know, in your room, it's gonna pull eyes to it if you're that way inclined. It's a very arty speaker. I quite like it for that as well. Yeah, that's about where I'm at with this. Overall, I'll get to my overalls after we've spoken about this one. Special 40, less splash, more focus and direct presentation. Immediately when they were plugged in, the stage, which I've got a great analogy for here, which I've just come up with, which I'm chuffed with, when, like so, the resolution stayed the same. So it became more focused, more direct. It was immediately more obvious where things were within that, even though it was a smaller stage. By less splash, I'm talking about that handover again. So that handover between the top of the mid-range and the bottom of the higher frequency causes a bit of splash. It causes a bit of sort of confusion in that wide open space. And this doesn't have that at all. It's not there. So you kind of listen to this and then you listen to that, and what happens is, and here comes my analogy, if you think about your stereo image as an actual image, as an actual picture, if it was say 3000 by 2000 pixels or whatever it would be, the Concept 300 spreads that same amount of pixels over a larger area. Okay, the Special 40 keeps that image the same but uses the same amount of pixels. So effectively you have higher definition per area, if you know what I mean. If you spread it out, there becomes a much wider stage, but the focus is spread across a wider area. Therefore, this is a much more focused and direct sounding, more sort of realism for its sound stage, if that makes sense. I mean, it makes perfect sense to me. But yeah, so this kind of throws up a larger image, but this one throws up an image that has a relative boundary. It's wider than speakers, but it's extremely focused inside of that box. And that's what I mean. So I've put a very accurate image, good from cold. As I explained with this is the only speaker that I know other than the 500, which needs a little bit of, you know, you've got to dig a bit when you turn it on. You know, it needs waking up. You know, it's like a grumpy old bear. So HF, not as locatable.
i.e. I can't sit here and go that treble sounds fantastic or that tweeter is beautiful, because what it does do, which is my next point, is it just blends into the speaker. It blends in into the whole thing without making itself pronounced. You never sit there and think there's a lack of energy here, there's a lack of high frequency energy here. You would if you were to have this one on the left and this one on the right, the brighter speaker would obviously be the 300, but you would never accuse the Special 40 of being dull. It really isn't. It's just that its tweeter blends so much better, and that goes back to the less splash statement I made at the beginning. Blends away just right, a calm and relaxing listen. Genuinely, about five or six tracks in, I just sat back and put one foot up, and I just sort of caught myself just calming down, just chilling out. Now, when I'm sort of clinically listening, I'll sit forward on my seat, and I'll look at the speakers, and I will I'll weigh them up, you know. But with these, I just sort of, you know, I just calmed down and I was listening to music. I've put less focus on resolution, more focus on cohesion. That's extremely obvious between the two. This speaker is more phase coherent, so sounds more real than this speaker. That's just a fact. This one has certain things that are very good, but this one, you know, if you were trying to replay yourself speaking to yourself and have a conversation and be fooled by that other person being a real person, that would be the one. Singing again, which makes me think that it wasn't these speakers that was making me sing, it was just the music I was listening to. But you can add clicking to this one as well. So in the elaborate reactions top trumps, the Special 40 wins. Now, the next one, I put less overall depth for the Special 40 compared to the 300, much more bass definition and detail. And then about 3 minutes later, I boxed off less overall depth and I wrote not true underneath it. This speaker, the Special 40, plays lower than this speaker. Quite obviously so as well. And maybe I hadn't given it the right amount of time before I wrote that. I'm not too sure, but there was certainly a part of a Glass Animals track which has a really nice rolling bass line. And this one dug not just a bit deeper, it was a fair amount deeper. Now, that will be helped by its definition and the more detailed bass. So it'll give you that emphasis of it being much lower than it is, just because it has such good control of its bass throughout its bandwidth. The bass, There isn't a weak point. You know, the bass is incredible on this. The mid-range crossover, you know, the handover between the two drivers is as close to perfect as I've heard, regardless of price point. Because, you know, a good crossover does not a high-end speaker make. It's just, you know, you can get a good crossover between two terrible drivers, but the crossover, you can hear it. You can hear how it hands over. You can hear how phase coherent those two are, how aligned they are in time. And this does it like no speaker I've ever heard, really. Well, probably other than the Heritage Special, which is just, you know, just gorgeous, or any other higher end Dynaudio speaker. But you know that about me by now, the mid-range and Dynaudio speakers. I'm not biased. That's just, they do that the way that I like them to be done. I don't reference that against any other speaker. I wouldn't say that this has bad mid-range, because this has good mid-range. If the mid-range on this caught my ear like these do, I'd be, you know, I'd be singing their praises about their sort of mid-range response. So excellent finish, small footprint. Now, this is a big deal, actually. These, get moved around this place quite a bit because they take up a lot of space. They're big, you know. I mean, they're huge actually for a stand mount. Think high end stand mount. They're typically quite big and bulky. But this is kind of that, you know, that sort of size. The Tensegrity stand takes up the footprint of probably 3 or 4 of the stand 6, which is now going to be obsolete. So it'll be stand 10 will be their entry stand, I think. So that's worth bearing in mind. If you've not got a lot of space, you'll struggle to fit that stand in there. Plus, you have to use this stand with the speaker because you'd be wasting your money if you didn't, because of the way that it decouples the speaker from the stand. I can't stop doing it. I love it. Because it looks like, it really looks like it shouldn't do that, but yeah. Whereas the stand 6 has the same sort of Evoke style footprint, basically the same footprint as a Special 40. If you were to sit this on the floor, that's how much it takes up. Excellent finish. I mean, of course, this has an excellent finish. The new ones, their finish is just unbelievable. I've never seen a finish like it on a speaker, regardless of price point. They've done something really, really special with that. I said earlier on it was a landslide. The Special 40 is a better speaker. The Special 40 is better than the Concept 300. It has better bass, better mid-range, more relaxed top end. It plays lower, it plays louder. It has a smaller footprint, but that's not, you know, it's quite subjective. Now, you know, I can't, that doesn't mean, and I know it sounds cliche, but that doesn't mean the 300 is a bad speaker. It really isn't. It's a very special speaker, actually, at its price point. You know, it's been reviewed really well. It's held really well, or held in high regard by the people that have actually given it the time. Now, I don't know if any of those guys have ever just sat these two side by side and compared the two, and have sort of their opinions, but in this battle they've met their match and some, you know. Dynaudio, as I've said in a number of videos now, every now and again will release a special speaker that I genuinely believe is 50% of its actual price point. So they'll release a Special 40, it'll be $2,500. That speaker has got trickle down tech from speakers that are £50,000, £60,000, £70,000, almost like a loss leader, almost like a, here you go guys, have a special speaker for next to no money, let's bolster the rest of our sort of speaker sales. They're a business, that's what they have to do. But the Special 40, I think in years and years to come, will still be held as one of the best speakers that have ever been made. And that's not me fanboying. That's just, it's very obvious value for money. Now, yeah. When I started this video and I said it was going to be closer than what you think, I thought these were going to win. Because I've listened to these in isolation, and I've listened to these in isolation. I know them both very well. I may have to do a round two, because the Hegel H390 may just sound better with the Dynes. But this is the beauty of it all, isn't it? I could review 1,000 things in 1,000 different scenarios and they'll all sound different. But I've heard this sound really special from the Peachtree Audio Nova 300, which is right there. Which is what I use in my little summer house at home. Just because I like the way they work together. So it might be that I ship in the Nova 300 and listen to the two there, because these I've not listened to on that. Them I have. Yeah. This one gets my money. This one still gets my money. But if there was a speaker that I had to have, it's going to be the Special 40. Hopefully that's been in depth enough for you. If there's something I've missed, which I probably have, there's probably all sorts that I've missed, just drop me a a comment below, and I'll do my best to answer. I'll try my best to answer all of them. Hopefully this is a review that you've been looking at being done for a while. But yeah, like I say, don't discount the 300 because the Special 40 is better, because that's my opinion, and yours could be completely different. The pronounced high frequency, the actual bass depth that it does, the decoupling it has from the room, they're a magnificent sounding speaker. So it's only my personal tastes, I suppose, that bring these, that hold these in high regard. All right, guys, I'm Carl, this is Studio Hi-Fi. I'm going home because I've been here for hours and hours. These sheets of ours shield our bodies like a fortress. They keep us safe from harm. Intertwined, our bodies lay there like a coma. And I'm a fool for the sight of all the gold between your thighs. You still the sea that's standing in me. Make your bass right here next to me is on a splendid harmony. And when we sex, we hear the beat, and it's so serene. Pull me under the ocean. Cover my mouth with your